SANDHAN All Gujarat Integrated Classroom
Satellite ના માધ્યમથી જોડતી કડી એટલે SANDHAN
નમસ્કાર વિદ્યાર્થી મિત્રો એકેડેમિક યર 2012-13 ના આ ત્રીજા માઇક્રોબાયોલોજી લેક્ચરમાં હું કુણાલ ઉપાધ્યાય રાજકોટથી આપનું હાર્દિક સ્વાગત કરું છું ટુડે વી વિલ ડિસ્કસ ઓન વન ઓફ ધ મોસ્ટ ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ એન્ડ વેરી ઇન્ટરેસ્ટિંગ ટોપિક દેટ ઇઝ સોઇલ માઇક્રોબાયોલોજી એન્ડ વી વિલ ડિસ્કસ સોઇલ માઇક્રોબાયોલોજી ઇન સમ ડિટેલ વી વિલ મેઇનલી ફોકસ ઓન સોઇલ Rhizosphere and humus because we know that soil is the medium in which we are performing our daily or day-to-day activities. Plants are directly connected or dependent on soil while we are indirectly depend on soil. So this topic soil microbiology it is mostly coming in most of the universities it is coming in TY microbiology as well as in MSc microbiology also. So it is very useful to all biological sciences students that is soil microbiology. We will discuss this is our outline of this today's lecture that is first introduction about soil and all the root morphology. Then we will go for microbial flora of rhizosphere. Then effect of plant on microbes of rhizosphere, then effect of microbes on plant in rhizosphere, then mycorrhiza, then symbiotic nitrogen fixation, that is also one of the more important function of this place that is called rhizosphere. Then we will go for some negative aspect of this relation that is plant pathogenesis and rhizosphere. And at last we will discuss the second half of this lecture that is related to soil organic matter which is popularly known as SOM SOMs or humus is the main thing and at last structure of humus and chemical composition of humus and conclusion. First of all friends what is soil? Soil is very rich medium for the cultivation of microbes as we know microbes are omnipresent on earth and mostly they are found with soil, air and water. Amongst these three soil is the most nutritious and it is the most medium in which microbes can be easily cultivated and they will derive their all requirements for their growth and reproduction from the soil. In soil microbiology particularly Martinus Behring and Sergei Vinogradsky he belongs to Russian scientists they are considered as the pioneer scientist of soil microbiology or they are also known as father of soil microbiology branch and because they have contributed a lot in this era or in this branch that is called soil microbiology. The definition of soil is soil can be defined as it is a region at where biology and geology meets. Biology means living things while geology means non-living things. So we can say that friends soil is neither a purely non-living item or nor it is purely living things. It is a mixture of both. Biology part is also there and non-biological part that is called geological part that is also coming with soil. So this is the definition of soil. Soil is the region at where biology that is living system branch and geology that is called non-living system branch they both are meeting that place is known as soil. Before going in any detail about rhizosphere first of all we will discuss some basic aspect about root systems. See friends we know that roots are very important part of any plant system because roots are there for which supports the plant growth and which nourish the plant because we know that plants uptake the nutrients and minerals via these roots. Basically roots are of two types as shown in this diagram. One is called tap root and another one is known as fibrous root. In some of the plant tap root is found in some of the plant fibrous root is found. Root may occupy almost 1% of total volume of soil about total volume of soil from it is 1% is occupied by roots in wildland that is called in forest or in grassland or in even equatorial region or in such forest, almost 50% of the soil root or soil part is occupied by root, because there is a thick cover of vegetation is found, and most of the root part is found in this part. While in agricultural sector, friends, 25% of the total area of the soil is occupied by roots, because in agricultural land also humans are cultivating their crops, and these crops are further they are useful for nutritional purpose of mankind. Root systems are having different depth. It all depends on the type of plant. In some of the plant, depth may be merely 30 centimeter like lettuce, while in case of cotton it may be 120 to 150 centimeter, or in alfalfa plant it may be 250 to 300 centimeter. In turf it is 60 to 90 centimeter, while certain plants are there like mesquite plant, in which the depth of root system, it may be up to sometimes 50 meter or more than 50 meter also. This kind of root systems, friends, generally found in some desertic soil, or you may say in some xerophytic plants, in which some water scarcity is very common problem, and they have to search water from very deeper areas of the soil. Friends, this is root morphology. Root is made up of different parts. Say for example, the last part, it is known as meristematic zone of the root, which is directly involved in root penetration and uptake of minerals and water and all the things. Above it, it is elongation zone. Elongation zone is generally useful for penetration of these root fibers inside the soil. Then it is coming next one. It is maturation zone. Maturation zone is useful for secretion of some of the important exudates, and some excretions are also coming out in this maturation zone. And at last, this is mature zone, which is usually it is propagated laterally instead of vertically, because this part is there from where the side branches or some other small root hairs will also coming from this mature zone. And this part is the cross section of maturation zone, in which friends, we can see some Casparian strip and symplast apoplast pathway for the uptake of minerals and waters, and these are very common things in almost all plants. As we have already discussed, root cap is used for the protection of meristem. Then another function of root cap is secretion of mucigel. Mucigel is it is gelatinous viscous material, and we will discuss about this later on after some few minutes. And the last function of root cap is initiation of symbiotic relationship. This part will also cover in later part of this lecture, when we will cover symbiotic interaction between nitrogen fixing organism and leguminous plants. Another thing is coming, that is elongation zone. Elongation zone of cells, they are useful for penetration of the root system through the soil, and they are most important one, because through this part usually roots elongated inside the soil, and they will uptake more and more nutrients. And then maturation zone is coming, which is made up of root hairs, and majority of the uptake of minerals and water and all this part is uptaken by generally maturation zone of root. Friends, now we will come on the point, that is rhizosphere. Rhizosphere is the area, or this term rhizosphere, it is first time it is denoted by one German scientist named Hillner in the year 1904. Actually, this part is somehow historical background of this rhizosphere and contribution of some leading scientist in this field, rhizosphere. So, Hillner is the pioneer person for rhizosphere, and the word rhizosphere is denoted by Hillner. Concept of rhizosphere phenomena, which shows the mutual interaction of roots and microorganisms, was came in existence with the work of Starkey et al. In 1929 and later on Clark in 1939, and then Roth and Kazin Eslan, he had given the concept in 1957. Clark in the 1949, F.E. Clark, he introduced a coin, the word rhizoplan, for first time. The rhizoplan is equally important part of rhizosphere because it is more near to the roots, and we will cover this rhizoplan somehow later on. Kesnelson in the year 1946, he suggested about R is to S ratio. That is the ratio between the microbial population found in the root area versus the microbial population found in the fallow soil or in bulk soil or in free soil. So this is one of the techniques to study rhizosphere effect. This is rhizosphere diagram, and these are few important or conspicuous characteristics or properties of rhizosphere. Say for example, in rhizospheric area, higher availability of carbon source for the microbial growth. There will be higher microbial population and density is also found in rhizosphere as compared to bulk soil or fallow soil. Friends, bulk soil means it is a barren land, or it is the soil which is yet not vegetated, or yet vegetative propagation is not occur. While fallow soil means the soil which is already prepared for vegetation, but yet seeds are not there, and yet it is not plowed, and yet it is not vegetation is not there. So rhizosphere contains most carbon source as well as higher microbial population. One more conspicuous characteristic of rhizosphere is lower pH than bulk soil. Why this pH is lower? That part is also covered in some later slide. Lower oxygen tension is also there in this area. Oxygen level is also less. And the last thing is some altered nutrients are also available in this area from plants. So, at last means what is rhizoplan? Rhizoplan means what? Rhizoplan is the area in, it is the, we may say that it is intimate area of root. Rhizosphere is somehow far area of plant, while rhizoplan is the intimate area where microorganisms are either attached or adhere on the surface of root, and they are at very effect of this root and all these exudates. So, rhizoplan is having more effect on microbes as compared to rhizosphere. Rhizosphere is somehow broader area as compared to rhizoplan. Rhizoplan is one of the part of rhizosphere only. In this diagram, we can better observe what is the difference between rhizosphere and rhizoplan. The entire diagram shows the rhizosphere, because rhizosphere can be defined in this way. It is the area of soil which is affected by activity of roots and plants. So, it is any infinite area which is affected by activity of root or any other plant exudates. That area is known as rhizosphere, while rhizoplan is very near surface of this root. We may say on surface of this root, or on microorganisms or soil which is attached to this surface, this area is known as rhizoplan. This part shows the area of soil environment in which some bulk tissues are also shown, and some secretion like mucigels are also occur, that is also shown in this diagram, and some anatomy part of root is also shown in this diagram, like some inner part of the root cap and root cells and all these things. Surface and subsurface soils are typically nutrient poor environment for microbes, because we know that soil, it doesn't contain any other organic material or any other thing. Soil only contains inorganic materials, but this organic part is coming from plant activities and from rhizosphere. In later slide, we will discuss O horizon and A horizon and B and C horizon. At that time, it will come. But generally, surface soil contains organic material from this plant, and due to this organic material, organisms, microorganisms, and some other organisms are also found in this area. Friends, this is the diagram of rhizosphere, actual photograph of rhizosphere. Here we can see some root systems as well as soils which are attached to these root systems. And this entire region which is influenced by the activity of roots and all these things, this area is known as rhizosphere. And this rhizosphere is having quite a dense microbial population as compared to some other far away regions from this area, because at their plant activities or plant root exudates or plant any influences are not there. So this is the actual photograph of rhizosphere, in which different types of roots as well as some soil or bulk soil, both things are shown in this photograph. Friends, this diagram is for rhizosphere and its some basic part. Rhizoplan is, as we have discussed just before, it is a soil in direct contact or influence of plant roots, and the microbes which are found to be attached on the surface of this root, they are known as endophytes. Endophytes are the members of rhizoplan only, and rhizoplan is the part of entire rhizosphere. Now these are the different parts of different types of organic materials which are secreted out from the rhizosphere or from root part of the plant. They are of mainly four types. There are four types of exudates or secretions are there. A very first type of organic material is coming exudate. Exudates are generally, friends, it is a low molecular weight compounds. They are released from the plant cells in non-metabolic manner. Non-metabolic manner means they are not the natural product or any natural secretory products of the plant. It is somehow, we may say, it is somehow leakage of the plant. There are so many such examples are there, like exudation of gum, exudation of resin, exudation of latex, and all these are known as gummosis, latexosis, resinosis in terms of plant pathology and all these things. So exudates are not the natural product. They are having low molecular weight and they are usually produced in form of leakage. While secretions are systematic products which are synthesized inside the plant, and metabolically it is secreted out from the plant, and they will be affect on growth of microbes. A third secretion is coming, that is called lysate. Lysate is nothing but it is the compound which is released from moribund cells during the autolysis. We know that plants are continuously, root cells are dying, and this dead tissues or whatever things are coming out, it is generally coming out as a lysate. It contains generally dead organic matter, and dead organic matter is generally not used by rhizospheric organism. It is generally used by saprophytic organisms, or which are popularly known as saprobes. Last one is plant mucilage. Mucilage is one kind of plant polysaccharide, and it is naturally formed from the plant root, and we will discuss its function and its structure and all the things in some later slide. This is mucigel. Mucigel is a slimy substance that covers the root cap of the root of the plant. Generally it is a hydrated polysaccharide, and most likely it is made up of pectin, and which is secreted from the outermost, that is called epidermal cells of the root cap. Now why it is formed, what is the significance, what is the importance of this mucigel from plant anatomy, that we will discuss right now. Mucigel is formed in Golgi bodies of this epidermal cells of the root cap, and then later on it will be secreted by the process of exocytosis. Friends, you might have heard the word GERL system, and this GERL system, that is called Golgi endoplasmic reticulum and lysosome system. This system is helpful in exocytosis. Exocytosis means it is the movement of this mucigel or polysaccharides from inside to outside the plant. So mucigel is forming inside the Golgi bodies, and it is secreted out the cell. Now why it is secreted? Because it is having some functions to perform in root area. first function is coming, that is called protection of root cape, or it prevents desiccation in root area, because we know that generally this mucigenol, as we have discussed in last slide, mucigel itself, it is highly hydrated polysaccharide, and if root cells facing any drought condition or any water scarcity or any water severity condition in this area, then what happens, it this desiccation condition can be prevented by presence of mucigel. It also serves the function of lubricant for root cap, and it also allow more efficiently to penetrate this root cap inside the soil. Otherwise, sometimes it may cause some mechanical injuries in the root cells, and ultimately it may cause some infections, and then root cap or root cells may also die if such lubricants are not found on the cap of root. Another significance of mucigel, in because mucigel is very important exudate, or it is very important substance in rhizosphere, because it provides some sticky or gummy environment for the adherence of microorganism in this rhizosphere. So it creates some symbiotic environment for the fixation of nitrogen fixing bacteria like rhizobium. When rhizobium organisms will come on the root, and when they will make the penetration into the root, at that time, at first sight, they will attach on the this mucigel, and mucigel will help in water absorption. And it also provides a diffusion bridge between the final root system and soil particles, which allow a more efficient uptake of minerals and soil water, or rather soil solution, inside the root. So these five or six important functions are there, which are performed by mucigel in this rhizosphere, and they are the main important factor which facilitates the formation of rhizosphere in this area. Friends, these are the densities of microorganisms in rhizosphere. Here some bacterial counts and fungal counts, protozoan counts, and denitrifier and actinomycetes count are shown, and they are counted in form of CFU, that is called colony forming unit per gram of the soil, and they are shown in rhizospheric soil as well as in non-rhizospheric soil. So first column is coming microorganism, second column is coming rhizospheric count, third column is coming non-rhizospheric count, and the last column is coming, that is R is to S ratio, and these figures are particularly shown with reference to wheat plant, that is called triticum sativum. Now we will discuss microflora of root zone, means what kind of microorganisms are found in this root area. So if you want to study the microflora of root zone, then we are having three specific type of techniques for study of this kind of microflora. They are cultural techniques, then it is coming microscopic techniques, and at last it is coming biochemical techniques. These techniques are useful to study both qualitative as well as quantitative aspect of microflora of root zone, means how many types of microorganisms are there, as well as how many numbers of microorganisms are there. So both are covered under this heading, that is microflora of root zone. Microscopical analysis shows that rhizosphere contains almost all types of microorganisms in it. Bacteria or unicellular microbes are quite common as compared to mycelial or filamentous microbes, and in bacteria also almost all kinds of bacteria, they may be size wise or they may be shape wise or arrangement wise, all types of microorganisms or bacteria are found in this area. They may be found either in chain, or it may be also found in individual cell also. Filamentous fungi or actinomycetes are not that much common in this area, because they are having some inhibitory effects in this area. So bacteria are more common. Protozoan are also found, because we know that protozoa are mainly they mainly feed these bacteria. So wherever bacteria are common, protozoa are obviously common, and all types of protozoa like bodo or paramecium or plasmodium, or all these protozoa are found here, like ciliates, flagellates, and all types of protozoa are found in this. Even amoebic protozoa are also there in this area. How to do cultural analysis of this rhizospheric region? Then second method is cultural analysis, and in which plate count is very common method. Plate count is as good as our viable count technique. Here SPA medium can be used, that is called standard plate count agar. Or if it is not available, then we may go for our natural or our usual N agar also, that can also be used. RS to S ratio is studied here. RS to S ratio is very important parameter to study overall effect of root on microbial growth. RS to S ratio gives generally good picture of this effect of rhizosphere. Here generally rhizospheric soil and non-rhizospheric soil, that is called bulk soil or fallow soil. Both of these soils are separately taken, and their viable count or this plate count practical is carried out, and then as per the equation N equal to Y upon Vx, or from colony forming unit, we may come to know which area contains more number of microorganism, and that will give you idea about RS to S ratio will give you idea about rhizosphere is having more prominent effect as compared to bulk soil. Now, what type of bacteria are found in this area? Then usually bacteria are having very high RS to S ratio as compared to actinomycetes or fungi or any other mycelial organism. Generally, we may encounter gram-negative bacteria, rod-shaped bacteria, non-sporulating bacteria which respond to root exudates. Most prominent are pseudomonas, or even agrobacterium are also found in this area. Not only gram negative, but gram positive bacteria are also commonly found, because most of them are saprophytic organisms, they are aerobic organisms. So rhodes, cocci, spore forming bacilli, clostridium organisms, they are also found in this rhizosphere. Most common genera of bacteria found in this area, they are pseudomonas, arthrobacter, acromobacter, alkaligens, azotobacter, mycobacterium, flavobacter, cellulomonas, and micrococcus. So we may say that all kinds of positive, negative, cocci, rod, spore forming, non-spore forming, all types of bacteria are almost covered in this area. Not only this type of organism, but even a nitrogen fixing organism as well as phosphate solubilizing bacteria are also more frequently found in this rhizospheric area. Aerobic organisms are usually less found, because as we have discussed in our one of the earlier slide, in rhizospheric area generally oxygen tension or oxygen availability is less, because root is also making the respiration and microbes are also making respiration. So both of these respirations ultimately leads to depletion of oxygen in this region. Bacterial population in rhizosphere. See, qualitative population we have discussed. Now this is quantitative figures of bacteria in rhizosphere. They may ranging from 10 raised to 8 to 10 raised to 9 per gram of rhizosphere soil, and generally 4 to 10% of total root area is covered by bacteria or microorganisms in this area. Microorganisms or bacteria are generally found on root hair and rarely found on root tips, because as we know, root tips are having the function to deep penetrate inside the soil, so they may not bear the microorganisms right there, but root hairs are having common these microorganisms. Whatever microorganisms or whatever requirements are there of bacteria, as far as amino acid requirement is concerned, or any growth factors, or even any other growth requirements, these growth requirements and amino acids are they are fulfilled by root exudates or plant exudates in this region, and that is the main reason why the rhizospheric area is this much fertile or this much microbial growth supporting as compared to bulk soil. Now we will cover some of the factors affecting the distribution of microbes in rhizosphere. The first factor is coming, that is called depth of sampling. We know that frequency of bacteria, fungi, algae and other bacteria, usually their number and diversity, both thing is getting decreased as depth of soil is increased, because we know that as depth of soil is increased, oxygen availability is also decreased, as well as availability of organic matter, light and all these things are decreased. So obviously there will be more population is found in surface soil or in subsurface soil, while there is less population is found in deeper region. Second thing is coming, that is plant species. Plant species are also having some influence on rhizospheric flora, because some of the plants are encouraging the growth of microorganism, while some of the plants are discouraging, or even they may sometimes inhibiting the growth of microorganism in this area. For example, legumes are having good tendency to support the growth of rhizobium in their area, while grass is having less number of microbes in their roots. Even we may found that biennial plants are having more prominent microbial flora as compared to annual plants, because we know that biennial plants are having the longer lifespan as compared to annual plants. So they are having longer growth phase, and there will be more types of microorganisms are found in this area. And third region is coming, that is called age of plant. Usually young seedlings are also, they are having a positive effect on rhizospheric microbial flora as compared to old age plants. Usually old age plants supports the growth of saprophytic organisms, while young seedlings are having all the metabolic process fast and active. So they are having more prominent secretions and exudations, and that will ultimately leads to growth of microorganisms in this area. This is some physical environment of rhizosphere. Why rhizosphere supports this much growth in that region? The first thing is coming, water potential. Usually plants transpire the water more in daytime as compared to night time, or as compared to dark time. So during daytime there will be more water potential is found in the soil, and this high water potential is one of the reason why microorganisms are most commonly found in this area, because microbes cannot survive without water or in dry condition. So they can grow in this water containing area, because moisture or water is given by this rhizosphere. Second factor or second characteristic of soil physical environment, that is called soil texture. Usually sand or such type of soil are having larger pores, so they are having more exudate travel space, or we may say void space. There will be more void spaces found in this area, so microbes will get more secretions in this area as compared to some silty or some other large size particle soil texture. pH is also having prominent effect on rhizospheric flora. Here lower pH is found in this area because CO2 level is high, and CO2 is getting dissolved in this soil water, and it will ultimately form carbonic acid and bicarbonates, and that will ultimately leads to lowering of pH, and lowering of pH will also facilitate solubilization of phosphorus and all this thing, and ultimately it will give positive effect on microbial growth in rhizosphere. These are the various products which are excreted by normal course of plant roots, and which are uptaken by microorganisms, and they will show their growth in this area. All types of amino acids, all 20 or even more than 20 types of amino acids are found in this area. Varieties of organic acids are also quite common in this area, like acetic acid, butyric acid, citric acid, fumaric acid, lactic acid, and almost all tartaric acid, valeric acid and all. All types of polysaccharides, they may be even pentose sugar, hexose sugar, disaccharide, oligosaccharide, polysaccharide, all types of sugars are also excreted out by plant in this area, and they will be ultimately useful as a nutrient for rhizospheric organism. not only these carbohydrates and organic acids and amino acids, but even some important growth factors are also very common in this area, like PABA, that is called para-amino benzoic acid, biotin, choline, inositol, nicotinic acid, pantothenate, pyridoxamine, and thiamine. Means almost all kinds of vitamins are also available in this area, so microorganisms growth can be obviously encouraged in this area. All types of enzymes are also found in this area, like amylase, invertase, phosphatase, protease. So these enzymes are readily formed in this area, and they are also available for the growth of rhizospheric organism. And other than all these compounds, some other miscellaneous compounds are also quite common in this area. They may be auxins, glutamine, glycoside, para hydroxy benzoate, peptides, saponin, and even scopolamine, that is some of the plant hormones, and they also encourage the growth of microorganisms in this area. Now, how plant influence the rhizospheric region, how they facilitate growth of microorganism, and later on we will discuss how microbes facilitate the growth of plant, because this is one kind of symbiotic interaction between plants and microbes. So here, first reason is there will be high carbon dioxide concentration is formed, and high carbon dioxide concentration will lead to formation of carbonic acid, and this carbonic acid will lower down the pH. So phosphorus and some other minerals which will remain otherwise insoluble, they will also get dissolved, and they will be readily uptaken by microorganism as well as plants. So this is the first important influence. Second thing is coming, rhizosphere supports the growth of all kind of nitrogen related plants in this area. For example, starting from proteolytic microbes, then ammonifying organism, then it is coming nitrate forming organism, nitrifying organism, and at last even denitrifying organism, and then even nitrogen fixing organism are also found in this area. So we may say that almost complete nitrogen cycle is occur in this area, and this may occur due to formation of free nitrogen is available, as well as nitrates are also available, and there is some dead proteinaceous matter is also present, and some sloughed tissues are also present in this area. Apart from nitrifying or nitrogen related bacteria, cellulolytic microorganisms like cytophaga and sore throats are also very common, because these are somehow detritus organism, because this contain a significant amount of cellulolytic waste material of plant, root exudates, and this dead root tissues are degraded by this type of microorganism. Next thing is coming roots excretions, they are also having positive effect on germination of some resting structure of fungi, like Pythium and Alternaria and some other fungi. Sometimes roots also produce some antimicrobial substance which exerts negative effect on growth of fungus, and that is the main reason why filamentous organisms or mycelial organisms are found in less number in this area. Microorganisms are having some beneficial or harmful effect on plant in this area. First thing is coming interaction between rhizobium and leguminosity plant. Here they are quite famous for one symbiotic relationship in which both of them are benefiting to each other, and now we will discuss how exactly they are benefiting to each other. Legumes, they preserve the nitrogen balance in the soil. They may be of two types, legumes and non-legume. They release flavonoids which are used by microorganism. These are some pictures of nodule formation at where rhizobium will make some nodule, and they will lead to nitrogen fixation. This is positive effect of microorganism on plant. Nodule formation generally occur within 1 or 2 weeks of infection. When infection is occur, at that time they will form some nodulin protein, and bacterial cell is also changed to bacteroid formation, and this bacteroid formation will leads to formation of nodule. Nodulin is one of the main substance. Another thing is that leg hemoglobin, which is provided by plant. Leg hemoglobin protects nitrogenous system and enzyme of this organism, and fixation usually occurs after about 15 days of infection. Mycorrhiza is another beneficial interaction between plant roots and microorganism. This is the interaction between fungus and higher plants. Friends, this thing is known as, in Gujarati it is known as kavak tantu athwa the kavak mood. Kavak tantu, kavak mood na apde English ma mycorrhiza kahe chhe. And this mycorrhiza is one of the beneficial interaction which is found in rhizosphere only. This is the real picture of this mycorrhiza, in which root and some fungal mycelia or hypha are shown. This is the same diagram. One side it is mycorrhizal diagram is there, and another side mycorrhiza are not there. This is the types of mycorrhiza. Mycorrhiza could be of two types. One is endomycorrhiza and another one is known as ictomycorrhiza. Endomycorrhiza is the one in which fungus grow inside the root, while ictomycorrhiza means here fungus grow on the root. These are the types of some pictures of ictomycorrhiza. Here, this is some more examples of microorganisms or effect on plant, how microorganisms are stimulating or benefiting to plant in rhizospheric area. So, microorganisms may produce some cytokinin, gibberellins, indoleacetic acid and some other plant growth stimulating factors, which may ultimately encourage the plant growth. Another thing is phosphorus availability is also occur from with the interaction of microorganism, because otherwise phosphorus is remain insoluble in soil water and plant cannot uptake this insoluble phosphorus. Microbes are not only participating in uptake of phosphorus, but they are also participating in the uptake of manganese, iron, zinc, potassium and many other useful minerals which are essential for the plant growth and the life cycle. They also found to be remove some toxic compounds from this near root area, so that plant roots will be protected from this toxic effect of these toxic compounds. They may are having some effect like H2S removal. H2S is otherwise toxic to plant. One good example is paddy soil and H2S oxidizing organism. Paddy soil is having a high amount of H2S, and this H2S is removed by rhizospheric organism of paddy soil, rice paddy. Some microorganisms also provide some important enzymes in this area, like urease activities governed by microorganism in this area to barley, and protease activities given by microorganisms to wheat roots. Some microorganisms may also produce some antibiotics like substance, which ultimately they will protect the plant roots from root pathogens. Sometimes plant pathogens may also come in this area, and they may cause some disease to plants, like some fungal pathogen and saprophytic organisms are quite common in this area, and usually they are very common to cause disease in plant. Each plants are not equally susceptible to infections of microorganisms, and all pathogens are not equally potent to cause infection. So ultimately this aspect may vary from plant to plant as well as from pathogen to pathogen. Friends, this is all about plant rhizosphere area and all the things. Now we will discuss brief things about soil humus and organic matters. This is soil profile. Uppermost area is known as O horizon. Later on it is coming A horizon, that is black colored one. Then it is coming B horizon, and then at last it is coming C horizon. The black colored of A horizon, that is due to presence of organic matters in this area, and these organic matters are popularly known as soil organic matter, and they are having humus in it. Humus is having this black color and it gives some fertility to the soil. Soil organic matters are having, this is a proportionate chart, living organisms constitute less than 5% of the area, fossil residues are present in almost less than 10%, decomposing organic matters 33 to 50%, while majority 50% of the part that is shown in yellow colored in this diagram, that is made up of humus. So now let us discuss some basic things about humus. What is humus and what is the chemistry of humus? Humus can be defined in this manner. It is amorphous. Amorphous means, friends, we cannot determine, or yet we don't know, what is the exact structure of this humus. It is having colloidal nature. It is microbially processed or microbially altered, and it is relatively stable portion of the soil organic matter, means it is not readily decomposed by microbes. Humus formation starts from condensation of phenolic and amino compounds, which are derived from organic matter breakdown. This we will discuss in later slide. See here, plant residues are there. They are transformed by microorganisms, and ultimately sugars, polyphenols, amino compounds, and lignin, or modified lignin, are coming in this area. Later on, they are converted to quinones, and these quinones are ultimately leads to formation of humic substance in the soil. Polyphenol theory is quite common theory for the formation of lignin and humus, but yet actual theory is yet not completely understood. But polyphenol theory is quite common one. As per this theory, lignin part is degraded to polyphenols such as catechol, and this catechol is further, at last it is oxidized to quinones. These quinones react with amino compounds and amino acids to form nitrogenous polymers, and at last they will form a larger nitrogenous stable compounds, which are ultimately known as humus. We can see this the same thing in this diagram, where lignin is attacked by microorganisms and it is converted to phenolic aldehydes and acids. Later on, it is further utilized by microorganisms and oxidation in CO2. Some of the part is converted to polyphenols. Polyphenol part is further converted to quinones, and this quinone is at last converted to humic acid and fulvic acid in the soil. Even cellulose and other lignin substances are also, ultimately they are converted to polyphenols, and polyphenol is ultimately leads to formation of quinones and then humic acid. This is one more diagram which shows the same formation of humic substances in soil. Now the very important basic question is coming, that is, why humus is so much stable? Humus is stable due to there are five reasons are there. First reason is coming, that is extensive interaction with soil minerals like clay, oxides, or amorphous materials. Second reason why humus is stable, that is very large structure. Large structure prevents its own degradation from microorganism. Third thing is coming, most of the part is hydrophobic and globular structure. Due to hydrophobicity, it is non-polar somehow, and it is not get mixed with soil water, and until and unless it is not get mixed with soil water, microbes cannot make the degradation of humus. One more reason is low solubility. As we have discussed in previous reason, due to hydrophobicity, the solubility part of this humus is less, and due to less solubility, it is not readily get dissolved in water and microbes cannot uptake. And even this polyaromatic extensive cross linkings are also responsible for inactivation of extracellular enzymes. Friends, we know that cellulose, starch, and all these things are ultimately degraded by extracellular enzymes, but here, due to polyaromatic structure, these extracellular enzymes themselves, they will be trapped in this humus, and ultimately it will be inactivated, and thus humus is remains stable for longer period of time in this soil. Humus provide quite huge anionic surface, so it will provide cation exchange theory in the soil. So plants uptake all the required cations in the soil from humus. This is the last part of today's lecture, that is humus chemistry. Humus is basically divided in three parts: humin, humic acid, and fulvic acid. Humin is the very small part, it is non-NaOH dispersible fraction, so it can be first separated out from NaOH because it will not disperse from here. Then humic acid part is coming. Humic acid can be solubilized in NaOH, but it is insoluble at pH 2. The molecular weight wise, the majority part of the humus is covered by humic acid, because it contains almost 10,000 to 1 lakh dalton molecular weight, and it is having aromatic rings, cyclic nitrogen compounds, as well as there are so many amino compounds, peptide bond containing compounds, and all these things are coming in humic acid. And the third part of this humus is known as fulvic acid. Fulvic acid is soluble in NaOH, and it is also soluble at pH 2. So this is the difference between humic acid and fulvic acid. It is having small molecular weight, that is 1000 to 30,000 dalton, and it is highly oxidized aromatic ring structure. These are some references for this topic, that is Introduction to Soil Microbiology by Alexander, Soil Microbiology by Mark Cohen. These two are very standard, authentic, and basic books of humus and rhizospheric soil. And at last, Wikipedia or some website references are also readily available for this one. So friends, this is all about today's lecture, that is called Rhizosphere and humus. We have discussed so many things about why rhizosphere is this much fertile, how it increases the fertility of soil, and why we should encourage the growth of plants and plantation and vegetative cover. Because friends, we know that plants not only cover, not only bring rains for us, but they also prevent soil erosion, and they maintain the soil fertility and nutritive value, and that is also due to this one of the part that is called rhizosphere. So friends, this is all about today's lecture, and if you have any queries or any doubts or difficulties or any questions, then your questions are most welcome.
SANDHAN, All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite na madhyam thi jodti kadi, etle SANDHAN.